Sahanao Bhunaktu Saha Viryam Karavavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastu Ma Vidvishavahai Om Shanti 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 Om Aapyayantu Mamangani Vakpranaschakshushrotramatho Balamindriyani Chasarvani Sarvam Brahma Upanishadam Maham Brahma Nirakuryam Mama Brahma Nirakaroda Nirakaranam Asma Nirakaranam Mestu Tadatmani Nirateya Upanishad Sudharmas Te Mahi Santu Te Mahi Santu Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
We will begin with chanting of Kena Upanishad.
Keneshitam patati preshitam manah Kena pranah prathamah praiti yuktah Keneshitam vachamimam vadanti chakshushrotram kaudevo yunakti Shrotrasya shrotram manaso mano yad vachoha vachagusa upranasya pranaha Chakshushas chakshurati muchya dhira pretyasmallokadamrta bhavanti Natatra chakshur gacchati navag gacchati no mano na vidmo na vijani mo yathaita danushishyat Anya deva tad viditadatho aviditadadhi Iti shushruma purvesham yenastad vyacha chakshire Yadvachanabhyuditam yena vagabhyudyate Tadeva brahmatvam vidhinedam yaditam upasate Yanmanasanamanute yena hurmanomatam Tadeva brahmatvam vidhinedam yaditam upasate Yachakshushana pasyati yena chakshu goshi pasyati Tadeva brahmatvam vidhinedam yadidam upasate Yachrotrena nashrunoti yena shrotramida goshrutam Tadeva brahmatvam vidhinedam yadidam upasate Yat pranena na praniti yena pranah praniyate Tadeva brahmatvam vidhinedam yadidam upasate
Sarvam Brahma, all this is Brahman, is the theme of all Upanishad. All the philosophies that are derived based on Upanishad, all of them have no differences in their perspective of understanding the statement that all this is Brahman. In what angle they see may slightly differ from philosophy or the schools of thought, but the matha of Upanishad is that all this is Brahman. That is what is coming in the invocation also that we chanted, Sarvam Brahma Upanishadam, all this is Brahman that is in Upanishad. This is a prayer that they are saying with conviction. And then they go on to say, Maham Brahma Nirakuryam, may I not disown Brahman. See, the two statements that are coming after that, may I not disown Brahman, may not Brahman disown me, this is not possible actually, but yet this is a prayer. May I not disown Brahman means, may I not remove Brahman from my thought, may I not deny his existence, may that conviction always be there in me. This is a very intellectual type of an appeal. It talks about the extreme conviction of the student that may I not remove it from my system. That sort of a intellectual conviction which leads to Shraddha, which leads to that faith. That is what he is appealing by saying that may I not disown Brahman. May not Brahman disown me. Brahman also cannot disown. Disown means what? To remove away from the system. It is not possible. See, if a king banishes somebody from the kingdom, what does it mean? What does he do?
He tells him to go somewhere else.
Somewhere else. So he is banished from the kingdom. If India banishes somebody from India, he is outside India. So if Brahman banishes somebody, what will happen? It is not possible. It is just not possible. Where will he go? Where is Brahman not there? That means there is a place where Brahman is not there. It is just not possible. May not Brahman disown me means, it is a very devotional appeal that please accept me. It's an attitude of surrender that is shown by the student and the master. I will not deny you. This I am having in my conviction. But at the same time, please you don't deny me. This sort of a devotion, this sort of a surrender is what we must remove. See, imagine if the, in talking about this, this Upanishad is talking about the Antaryami or the Brahman within you. How can Brahman deny you? If this body is denied, it becomes a dead body. But it cannot deny you as it is. You are not separated from it. It cannot be separated at all. So denial by Brahman is just not possible. Yet with surrender, there is an appeal made. Please accept me. You know, may you not deny me. This is the difference in the tone between the first statement and second statement. Both are meaning the same. But one is a intellectual conviction that I will not deny Brahman. Another is a emotional surrender with devotion that may not Brahman deny me. And then it shows the universal attitude of the prayer that it is not confined to me alone. May anyone not deny Brahman. This is the attitude. That is, let not anybody leave from this conviction of not disowning Brahman, not denying Brahman. And the universal prayer on their behalf also is that may not Brahman disown anybody. So the first two statements are looked at from individual point of view. The second two statements are understood from collective point of view. This is true prayer. You will find in this mantra or any Shanti mantras that there is absolutely no selfishness involved. Because most of the time prayer ultimately boils down to selfishness. What is there for me? It is not so. Even as they are saying, please protect, may our study become brilliant, everything is from the point of view of moving towards self-realization only. In another Shanti mantra, it says, may the trees grow well, may the animals be well, may the insects be well, may the Yajamana be well. So each and everything is only talking about a universal welfare. That is true prayer. A true prayer has no iota of selfishness in it actually. And if at all, whatever they are seeking, that is seeking for the sake of moving in the path of the truth. There is nothing worldly about this prayer. So he is saying, may anybody else also collectively not deny Brahman, may not Brahman disown anybody else. Tadatmani nirateya upanishat sudharmaha te mayi santu te mayi santu. He concludes with the confidence in the seeker to attain that self-realization. He says, I have worked hard and I have come up to this level. sort of I deserve it. So may all the virtues in the Upanishad be reposed in me. The qualities that are required, the virtues that are required for a person to seek realization, which are given as the path in the Upanishads, he is praying that those qualities let there be in me, because I want to be a qualified adhikari for that ultimate. So let, I have been practicing, let them be in me always. This is an earnest prayer. I have worked hard to come up to this level. May it continue to be in me so that I reach the goal. This is the prayer. What are the qualities? Qualities like ahimsa, qualities like various qualities are given. That whatever is the satyam, brahmacharya, whatever is the conducive qualities that are required for a student to seek the self through the study of the Upanishads, may they be always there in me. This is one way of looking at it. Another subtle way of looking at it is, the Atma Swarupa or the Brahman, which is the Supreme Truth, it has its own virtues. Virtues in the sense, the qualities of being without any name, without any form, all-pervading reality, that which is everybody, which is in everybody. These are the virtues of Brahman as it were, the qualities of Brahman as it were. Let them be always there in me. That means it is there always. Brahman cannot be differentiated from these qualities. It is there always. But let them be in my contemplation. Let them be in my anusandhan. See, all the time I am thinking myself to be a person who is doing punya or papa. Either I am a sinner or a person who is doing a virtuous person, etc. I am considering myself to be an individual who is a karta, who is a doer, who is a bhokta, who is an enjoyer or experiencer. All the time this is what I have been thinking of myself. Thinking of myself means this is what I consider myself. So the virtues in the Upanishad talk about those qualities in Brahman, which if I contemplate, I become that. That means it works on the principle of as I think, so I become. So may the qualities of the Brahman as given in the Upanishads be in my thought process always, so that by thinking about it, let me reach Brahman. This is a way of looking at it. So in terms of discernment, may I not discern Brahman. May those qualities be there in my remembrance, my contemplation all the time, so that I am attuned to it at all points of time. This is his prayer. In the previous one, what he talks about Nirakarana, it is not just about Brahman alone. Even this Brahma Vidya you can take. It is to be approached again and again. You see, after a point of time, you may think, yeah, it's the same thing. What is it that the master is going to say? In fact, I was listening to Swamiji's Ishavasya Upanishad of 1980s or 90s. It's a public lecture, and he says the entire Vedanta can be summarized, if at all, he says, in 15 minutes. Why 15 minutes? Even within 15 seconds or 1 minute. He says, what is the essence of Vedanta within 1 minute? Wherever you go, whatever you study, Vedanta, Bhagavad Gita or all other Upanishads, final essence is this only. So what is there after this to hear? It is nothing more to hear. Those who have been listening to Gita, they know. Those who have been listening to other Vedanta treatises, they know. Finally, you have to come down to that essence, or it will come down to that only. It is nothing more to be said. So what is there to listen more again? There is no entertainment here. There is no additional extra thing that is going to be said. Finally, it boils down to the same thing. So why bother? Let me go for... No, you have to be at it again and again and again. So therefore, the Nirakarana or the discernment is not with reference to Brahman alone. That's what is the real thing. But it is reflected on Brahma Vidya also. It is, so let me not discern this knowledge. let this knowledge also not disown me. May we have a long-standing relationship. That's what the prayer means. May we court each other so that there is a long-standing relationship, and then may all the virtues that are there in the Upanishads qualified for a qualified seeker, may they repose in me. This is a very, very sincere prayer before we launch on to the main Upanishad. So this, as I said, Kena Upanishad has these two. One is the general invocatory prayer, which is the Sahana Bhavatu. Second is specific for Kena Upanishad and maybe other Upanishads of this Veda. This one talks about the body, mind, everything being attuned to the study of Upanishads. And then again it concludes with three Shantis. The three Shanti refers to prayer that let there be no disturbance from all the three levels, so that our study let it be smooth. May there not be any disturbance at the cosmic level. May there not be any disturbance at the external level. May there not be any disturbance at the internal level, physical or mental internal disturbance. In other words, the Shanti Mantra creates a conducive atmosphere for the master and students to launch into the study of Upanishad. That is why it is to be chanted before the class, and they conclude with that also at the end of the class. Yes, sir.
So why doesn't the invocation say, like it says that Brahman doesn't disown me, I don't disown Brahman. Why doesn't it say that I also become part of Brahman? Because that is the final objective.
It is not part of Brahman.
Or I become?
Become. That's what it is. So the invocation is a prayer. Prayer is whenever we say a devotional thing. So when there is a prayer, that means there is somebody who you are praying to and whoever is offering the prayer. So therefore, there is that humility of the individual is actually showing himself at the lowest level with reference to the magnificence of Brahman. That's about all. So when you say, may not Brahman disown me, that means what? He is only accepting me. That means I am him. That's what it essentially comes down to. But we don't say it in that tone. May not Brahman disown me. May I not be disowned by Brahman. This is that a sincere and surrendering tone in which it is said. We'll chant the first mantra twice.
Keleshitam patate preshitam mana kena prana prathama praiti yuktaha keneshitam vachamimam vadanti chakshushrotram kaudevo yunakti keleshitam patate preshitam mana kena prana prathama praiti yuktaha keneshitam vachamimam vadanti chakshushrotram kaudevo yunakti.
By whom willed and directed does the mind alight on objects? Endowed by whom does the primeval prana, vital air, function? By whom willed does speech originate? What spirit indeed directs the eye and ear? As we have been saying always, the theme of Upanishads is Brahman, God. So when the seeker goes into the vichara or contemplation or thinking of what is beyond this all, what is the transcendental reality, that is what the ultimate question will come in some form or the other. What is interesting is not only this Upanishad, almost many Upanishads, they are also in the form of question and then answer. There is a Upanishad called Prashnopanishad itself. Prashnopanishad means there are six questions and six answers. The Upanishadic masters, they are waiting to give the knowledge. But the knowledge cannot be given is the principle. We are not talking about even Brahma Vidya. The rule applies to any knowledge. Think about it. Knowledge can never be given. Knowledge can only be taken. Knowledge can only be taken. When there is an earnest requirement of knowledge, the questioner or the seeker automatically draws the knowledge from any source. So the knowledge is taken before the seeking, before the quest. If you enforce the knowledge, chances are it will rebound back. It will not get inside. When you thrust the knowledge from outside without the other person wanting it, seeking it, it is going to rebound back. It will not seep in. But moment there is a urge, once there is a quest, and then the knowledge is automatically drawn inside. So here is the highest quality of student. We discussed about the differentiation between this type of student and where Arjuna also was a student. But in comparison, Arjuna is not anyway less. He was a great person. But at that point of time, he was a very depressed person before the Gita. So knowledge was sort of enforced by the situation. They're also very interesting. First chapter, when Arjuna is as though in a lecturing mode, Krishna doesn't speak a word. There is no Bhagavan Vacha in chapter 1. Chapter 2, first verse after Sanjaya describes, Krishna starts Bhagavan Vacha, he doesn't give lecture at all. He doesn't. The lecture of Krishna actually begins in the 11th verse. Arjuna little bit more says something in Bhagavad Gita chapter 2. Chapter 1 is, of course, after the initial description of the armies and other thing, it's only Arjuna who is speaking. So chapter 1 is dedicated to Arjuna's speech. And it is called as Arjuna Vishada Yoga. He is a very worried person. He is a depressed person. He is despondent state. That is Arjuna. Second chapter also he says. Now it is a very interesting analysis. Why not combine these 10 verses also in the chapter 1? And then chapter 2 onwards, it can be the real Gita begins. I mean, lecture of Krishna begins. It could have been kept like that. But there is a reason. What is the difference between Arjuna in the first chapter and Arjuna in the second chapter? Yes.
In the first chapter, he's just telling his troubles and he's also sort of giving answers in his own way. But in the second chapter, he begins to show, I want to know. Hmm. Like, I don't know, you tell.
Ha. In the second chapter, at least there is a confused state of Arjuna which is coming out. That confused state of Arjuna comes out after Krishna gives a very sort of a shock. He says, you are like a eunuch, he says, very powerful. Klaibhyam masmagamah partha, he says. I mean, if you are man here, you will come and fight. If you are woman, you will sit at home. What is there? You are coming here and crying. He gives such a very powerful shock treatment that rakes up the real issue. So, in terms of intellect, it was a tamasic intellect of Arjuna which is expressed in the first chapter. A rajasic intellect is shown in the second chapter. The tamasic intellect is very clear of the opposite. It says that adharma is dharma. So there is no doubt. That is why he is on a lecturing mode that we should run away. This is not the right thing. We will be incurring sin. All these things he is telling Krishna. In the rajasic intellect, he is confused about what is dharma and adharma. Once this confusion comes, only then there is a chance of knowledge seeping in. And then he surrenders saying, I am your Shishya, please tell me. So, there also the answer comes after there is a surrender by... Here Arjuna is the student and Krishna is the teacher. So, there are three types of students. One student goes to a class to show off his knowledge, very low category of a student. Another student goes to test the master whether he knows. That is even worse category of student. The third category is the right one. Irrespective of whatever he knows or doesn't know, he is going with the attitude of learning. So, in that learning process, if there is a genuine question that will come when you have a quest, quest is wanting to know. So questions don't arise to a person who is fully knowing something or who doesn't know anything also, he doesn't ask questions. Person who wants to know, he thinks, then he gets into problem, then he gets into doubts and confusion. That is a person who will ask this question. The type of question that Arjuna asks that we see, that also evolves over Gita, but how he asks in second or third chapter to that and compare to this question that a student asks, you will see how better qualified the student is. We studied the Tattva Bodha before the Upanishads. In that, basic concepts are all given. So we studied the body, mind, intellect, waker, dreamer, deep sleeper, various other concepts which are basic concepts of Vedanta. Here the question itself shows that the basic preparation of the student is there already. He has gone into deep research of certain things, and after having researched, he is coming up this question. Kena ishitam patati preshitam manaha. Manaha means mind. Kena means by whom. Ishitam means wished. By whose wish does the mind fall? Patati means fall. Fall means alights. You mind goes to Apple, we say, no? Mind goes to television. Mind goes to such and such person or object. So this mind goes to the object there and falls on the object. According to whose wish it goes? That is the question. Very deep question. Preshitam. Who directs it? Two words are being used here. Ishitam and Preshitam. By whose will, by whose wish it goes, by whose prerana it goes. Prerana means who is directing it. Who is stimulating it? Who is directing it? And by whose wish it goes? This is his question. Think about it. Have you ever thought of this question? Mind just goes. Mind automatically functions. What is your problem? What is this question seems per se absurd. Mind goes and falls on the object. We say this is the nature of the mind. It's my mind after all. My mind goes and falls wherever it wants to. It's my will. It's my this thing. Is it as simple as that? You want to wish about something, you want to think about something. Sitting in the puja room, you want to sit about, think about the God. Does the mind go to the God and alight automatically? It goes somewhere else. You don't want certain things to be thought of by the mind which you think it is fearful. There automatically it goes. So it is definitely, it is clear that it is not in your control. Somebody else seems to do it. That means what? I don't have any control over it at all. So why is it that sitting within me? Am I like a robo? Am I like somebody else gives a key and I am just like mechanically operating? Don't I have a wish or will of my own? That is also very clearly there. So this question is very deep in the sense, whose real wish is actually happening? And who is giving that prerana or the direction that it should go and alight there? Does mind have an independent existence of its own? Or is it somebody else using the mind? To what extent that person has a control over it? To what extent that somebody else has a control over it? So this is a question. Therefore, he is asking the same thing with reference to mind, with reference to prana, with reference to eyes and ears, with reference to speech. So in other words, he has analyzed the whole personality. What we study as a panchakosha viveka, five layers, etc. All that he has brought into this one question. Various layers that we have. We have the organs of actions that are functioning. See, the style of the Upanishad is that one organ of action is used to cover everything. So vacham is speech. All these people who are speaking here, by whose will the speech comes? That means speech is there. There seems to be a power which is making that speak. You go to a function, there is a microphone. That microphone is the mouth there. What is the power that is making that microphone function? He is not, see, now we can say electricity and other thing. We know the thing. I am taking example of the science. Assume a person, he is seeing all this expression functioning. He also seems to know that this, after this, they just wind up the mic and keep there. It's like a lifeless object. Who is it that, who is giving that life to the mic, which is blaring, which is affecting thousands of people? That is the speech. So that speech is there, it is affecting other people, others are also speaking, all this is happening. But what is the power that is making the speech happen? Who is the spirit who is connected to this eyes and ears? Eyes and ears are usually combined together to represent all the five senses. So organs of perception, organs of action is represented by speech. Organ of perception is represented by this eyes and ears. So eyes are seeing. Who is making it see? So this is my eye, this is my ear, this is my speech, this is my mind, this is my prana. All this is functioning from me, within me, originating from me. But all of them don't seem to function independently by themselves. So therefore, there seems to be something beyond it which he is really not able to grasp, which he is not able to really hold it. What is that he is asking? In other words, finally, all the questions in simple language comes down to who is that ultimate power? God, Supreme God, Self, Atman, Brahman, Spirit, whatever name you give. The final question of the Upanishad boils down to this only, that who is that Supreme Reality? This question, like what Arjuna is asking, please tell me, what should I do? Should I engage myself in action? Should I kill? All this confusion. This type of question is not in the Upanishad. In the Upanishad, the question is in terms of what is that reality? What is that truth? What is that God? You know, this type of question comes. So every question in every Upanishad somehow or the other will boil down to this essential question only. So in other words, he is asking, who is God? What is God? Is there something other power in me that is making all these gadgets function? Prana pratama praiti yuktaha. How does the primeval prana function? Prana is nothing but your battery. The life of, let's say, a mobile phone or computer, it is depending on the life of the battery, right? Once that battery goes, you have to replace that battery. The software in the computer is the what?
The mind.
It is the mind, it is the subtle body. The hardware in the computer is the body, gross body. These two come alive when there is a battery. When you switch on that power, that battery, does it have the power by itself? Or what is the source from which the battery gets the power? When the child is there in the womb of the mother, it is connected through the umbilical cord. So whatever nourishment is required for the child, it is passed on through that. And even through scan and other medical means, you know that the child is alive, it is functioning, heart is beating, all those things you know. But essentially, it is connected to the mother. God forbid, if the mother is dead, then there is no chance of that child that is surviving inside, that it will be alive. It will also go away. So, now if you ask, how does the child, who gives the power to the child, etc., the answer can be the mother, which is correct. Once the child comes out of the womb, what is the first thing that they do?
Cut
the umbilical cord. And then, how does it, they clean, and because even you see in animals also, it is there, covering, I think the cow also cleans the thing that is covering, so that there is, how does it start breathing sometimes?
It's
one smack they give, and it then the thing operates. So as though like sometimes in this remote and all it doesn't work, then you give it a smack like this, right? And then it begins to operate the battery. It like that, you give a whack and then it becomes it from there it continues as though something is waiting. And so this Prathama Prana can be equated to that. That prana which is going to function and sustain the child maybe 100 years or 80 years, it is going to function in him. That primeval prana, who made it function? It is not your, if it is in slap like that, when dead body is there, go and slap 10 times, will it happen? It doesn't happen. So something else is responsible for it. It is not in your slap. It is not in the mother or something like that. Then the question arises, what makes the mother breathe also? So the Prathama Prana or the first prana, on whose will does that function? Prana is something which never leaves you. When they say when you are dead the prana goes away, prana leaves the body. That is when the death happens. Body is disconnected. See, in technical language, the gross body and the subtle body are disconnected, and the subtle body moves with the prana only. That is why they say Atma moves. Atma means the Jivatma moves. The Supreme Atma doesn't move. The Jivatma moves with prana. That is why in Vishnu Sahasranama, Vishnu is given one name or one title, Vayuvahana. Vayuvahana means he travels with Vayu as the Vahan. That is along with the Vayu. Wherever you go, it is said that you go to Swarga, Naraka, come back, all this. Till the final thing, the prana does not leave you at all. That is why it's called as Mukhya Prana. It's Mukhya Prana. It's very important. It is inseparable from you. Maybe we do not know. Till realization, it is there. Now go back this side. Where it started, we do not know. But what was the cause of that first prana? But the fact is, now you know you are breathing. Prana is functioning. Who caused that first prana to function? How did that palpitation in you start? What is the cause of that? Very deep question. So he is using all the panchakoshas, he is using all the layers to ultimately ask this question as to what is the primeval cause? What is it that is making his everything function? This is the essence of this question. By whose will and whose direction does the mind alight on the objects? Who is making the primeval prana function? All of people who are speaking, what is making them speak? And chakshushrotram kaudev, the eyes and ears to which deva they are united, to which spirit they are united. Deva or spirit means there is a power behind the eye, there is a power behind the ear. Who is responsible for it? He doesn't know which god he is asking, which. Now, there is a, this is the question, that is why there is, you will find that question, ishitam, preshitam, all these words are used to convey that he has come up to a certain level, but he has to get the matter resolved at the highest level. Therefore, he is slightly confused at that point. Whether the prana functioning, is there a separate deva for it, separate god who makes it function? The shrotram, the chakshush, the eye, ear, is there a separate god for it? Are all the god same and one and the same? That is to be resolved. That is to be resolved. That is why he is asking this question. He is asking this question to convey that he is finally yet to clear that last hurdle. Meaning this person has come up to this level and is asking the question at the very final level. This is how we need to feel this question. It is not a mere intellectual transaction here. He has done all his hard work. He has understood various things about the personality. He has done his deep research. Finally, he is not able to resolve what is it finally. Because it cannot be obviously intellectually understood, but he wants to know it. That seriousness is there in that seeker. So he is asking this question in terms of what is the power behind all these things. Since he doesn't know whether all of them have the same power or not, he is putting down all the gadgets that he knows. what makes the mind function, what makes the prana function, what makes the ears function, what makes the eyes function, etc. Now here comes a magnificent answer. This is sort of Kena Upanishad. This is the real verse that is the capturing the essence of this Upanishad. Mantra 2 we will chant twice.
Shrotrasya shrotram manaso mano yad vacho ha vacha go sa upranasya pranah chakshushash chakshurati mucya dhira pretyasmaloka namrata bhavanti Shrotrasya shrotram manaso mano yad vacho ha vacha go sa upranasya pranah chakshushash chakshurati mucya dhira pretyasmaloka namrata bhavanti.
See, as we have been saying, this chanting of Upanishad is not as easy as Gita. So however much we are enthused, we should try to stick to the proper way of chanting. So I recommend you listen to the Upanishad chanting. Try to practice along with it. Because as Gita is a song, song can be sung anyway. But this is part of the Vedas, and the Vedic chanting has a particular meter, and that has to be maintained. So I would recommend that you listen to this Upanishad chanting whenever you, maybe when you travel in the car or whenever you have free time at home. Try to follow that so that it becomes easy for all of us to chant in this proper same way. When this question usually is asked as to who is God, what is God, what is the normal answer that is given in the world, we see? What is the normal answer?
Superpower.
Okay. Superpower, fine. It is another name for God. Then the question begs as to what is superpower?
One who controls all the world.
One who controls all the world. Fine. So he's all controller. Correct. Then?
Infinite.
Infinite mercy he has. Infinite love he has. Infinite power he has. That's why he's a super controller.
All pervasive.
Infinite length. Infinite space. Infinite. He covers infinite time. Everything is not wrong. All that the words that have been said could be correct. But the question, if the seeker is asking in terms of trying to understand what God is, the question is being asked because the God is unknown. God is an unknown entity. That is why the question is there. For what we know, for what is there in the world, you can see and know it. You can listen and understand it. You can either understand with your intellect, you can see with your eyes, you can know it. But here is something which cannot be understood. Therefore, that question of the unknown is asked as to who is... Because God is just another term. Like Swamiji gives the example of X in the mathematics. X is just a substitute. What is the length of the room means? You say, let the length of the room be X. X is not the answer. X is a term from which you have to proceed towards the answer. For most people, they took X as the answer and they were satisfied. So, after that, there is no inquiry. One in a million or one in a generation who asks this inquiry as to who is God, what is God. For him, if the answer is given, in terms of it is infinite love, infinite mercy, infinite power, infinite everything, infinite about him, all controlling, all pervading, all this could be correct also, but it really does not take the seeker anywhere because infinite is also unknown. One unknown entity called God cannot be understood by another unknown entity called infinite. The limitation of the intellect is that it can understand only something finite. Infinite cannot be known. Infinite cannot be known. If you know it, it is not infinite. Infinite cannot be known. That is why when you say fourth mantra when it comes, which is the real depth, it says it is beyond finite and infinite, it says. There it comes there, right? So, most people who give this as an answer and who are leading the masses actually are not taking them anywhere. You need at least one known entity from where you have to proceed. See, suppose a person wants to know where he is new to Calcutta, he wants to know where museum is. Then you say, where is museum? You don't know. It's very, very simple. You go to Park Street metro station. It is near that. That is Indian Museum. But this person doesn't know Park Street metro station. Oh, then you say, you go to this Jatindas Park metro station, take a ticket, 1, 2, 3, 4th station. 4th station is the Park Street station. And what you have said is right. But he doesn't know Jatindas also. So that's also not really helping him. Then you say, you don't know Jatindas Park. It is, you have to take an auto and ask for Hazra Mode. Hazra Mode is where this Jatindas Park metro station is. Then where to take a Baliganj Fadi? Baliganj Fadi I know because I have come to the class and I know it is near. So Baliganj Fadi is a known entity from where the journey starts. Then he goes to Hazra, then he takes a metro, then he goes to Park Street, then he goes to the museum. So the museum is an unknown entity, and all the explanations that you have given is also correct, but it is not helping that person. It will help the person only when he starts from a known factor. So at least one known factor has to be there to start. Incidentally, if you start from a known factor, only then, first of all, you are sure of where you are going. Second, you will enjoy your journey. Third, you will reach the destination. All these three things are there. You have to start from a known factor, then only you know which direction you will take. And once you are in the right direction, see, suppose if this is a metro train, you don't see anywhere. Suppose you go on a train which is on the surface and there are beautiful sceneries on the side, let us say. If you are always having doubt in the mind as to where you are going, which station, you are not sure of it, will you be really enjoying the sight outside? You cannot, because the mind is preoccupied somewhere else. But if you know you are in the right train, you know you are in the right direction, then you can always relax and see what is there outside. And you are sure to reach the destination also. Exactly like that, when we start the journey of God from a known factor, you are finally going to hit that goal, that is for sure. But along the way, you know various other things. In this process of learning that Indian museum, what all you have learnt? You have learnt Park Street, you have learnt Hazra Mode, you have learnt various other things, which are not really that you are really seeking, but it came along your way. You learnt various things. Similarly, when a person is having this target to go towards the God, he learns various things in the world itself along the journey. You will know probably how to relate with others. You will know how to achieve success in the world. You will know how to do karma in the world. All these things are incidental and necessary. Necessary. You cannot bypass this also, but you will learn it. And when you learn it and you are in the path, you are sure of the journey, you enjoy the journey also. That is also important. So it is not that reaching God, we do not know whether this janma or that janma, which janma we are going to reach, and then when you reach God, you are ultimately going to be very happy, infinite happiness. But till that time, we do not know. You suffer in this world. You will say, you keep your journey, I will be happy in my own way. It is not really worth pursuing a journey like that. The path also has to be happy. The destination also has to be happiness. That can happen only when you are sure of the path. So you will enjoy the world as it comes. So therefore, to enjoy your relationships in the world, to enjoy your karma in the world, to enjoy all the things that you do in the world also, you must set your goal right and be clear on that path. So always, not just here, in anything that you pursue, start from a known factor. The question is, what is God? Who is God? And that question he has put in terms of certain terms that he has understood. He has understood eyes. So he is asking what makes the eyes function. He has understood nose or ears. He is asking what makes the ears function. He is asking what makes the prana function. These are the things that he has asked. Now, very interesting, the master is using the same terms. The master is using the same. He doesn't use any word that he doesn't know, that the student doesn't know. He is asking, what is God? Who is God? In that terms, he is asking what makes the eyes function or ears function. He is giving the answer. Shrotrasya Shrotram. That which indeed is the ear of the ear. Be very careful with the translation that is given in the book. It's very important. First ear is given in capital ear. Second ear is given in the small ear. That which is indeed the ear of the ear, the mind of the mind, speech of the speech, prana of the prana, and eye of the eye. The wise, having completely freed and risen above this world, become immortal. What a statement. So, the question was asked in terms of these five things. Eyes, ears, prana, mind and speech. Same five things he says. It's a very interesting answer. He says, what makes the eyes function? What makes the ears function? He says, it is the eye of the eye. It is the ear of the ear. It is the prana of the prana. It is the mind of the mind. It is speech of the speech. Finished. Upanishad is finished. That's all. Question was given, answer is given, and the Upanishad is finished. We'll continue next. We'll conclude with the Bhajans here.
Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.